sitting here in the book of Ephesians. You can open your Bible to Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 through 21. It's a very long passage, so we're not going to read in the beginning. We're going to go through it. So Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 through 21. So let's pray, and then let's look at God's Word together. Father, we thank you, Lord. We thank you for giving us the faith to praise you. We thank you for the peace that you've given us in our heart, despite the circumstances in our life. Lord, thank you for giving us that faith, Lord. And thank you for encouraging as we share that faith with one another. Father, we praise you, Lord. Help us that we all may have faith like that, Lord, that we may praise you in all situations, where we complain to you too often, Lord, but help us to have a little more faith, a little more trust in you, Lord. Father, we trust that you love us, that all things are in your hands, and we look to you and we praise you in advance for what you will do in our lives. Father, we thank you for your love. Lord, we praise you. Father, at this time, we're about to hear your word, Lord. Father, speak to us, speak to our hearts, shine your light in our hearts. Father, I again confess, I have nothing, I don't know anything. Lord, at this time, I'm just going to share your word, Lord, do the rest. Speak to their hearts, convict them, Lord, and conform them and change them into your image. Father, I trust to you, Lord, in Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. My title is The Christian Walk. In the Bible, we are to walk. We are to live a different life because of God's grace, right? So Ephesians 1, 2, 3, again, is this, this is all the things that God has done through Jesus Christ. And from chapter 4 to chapter 6 is now this is how we should live. This is how we should walk. So it's, you know, it's on and on about this is how you should live, how you should live. Today's passage as well, 21 verses about this is how you should live, this is how you should live, right? Walk is a very important, it appears over and over in the Bible. Let me give you one example. Psalm 1, verse 1, it says, blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, right? Which you see over and over, right? Even in the book of Ephesians, each section starts with walk. Chapter 4, verse 1 through 16, it says what? As a prisoner of the Lord, that I urge you to walk a life worthy of the calling you have received. The next section was what? Chapter 4, verse 17 to 32. It says what? The very first verse says what? That you must no longer walk as the Gentiles do in the futility of their thinking. In our passage today, there is three walks. Walk, right? The first section is verses 1 through 7. Walk in love. And then the second section is verses 8 through 14, walk in light. And verses 15 to 21 is walk in wisdom. Alright? So, this is how we should live because we have received the grace. Right? We should walk. So let's look with me the very first verse, first section. Be imitators of God, therefore as dearly loved children. Right? Because you have been loved by God, right? Ephesians 1 to 3, because God has shown all that love in you, what should you be doing? You should be imitating God, right? You should have the characteristics on you, right? Put on the new life. And verse 2 says what? And live and walk a life of love, right? This is how you should live. Live a life of love. How? Just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God, right? You are to remember Christ's love for you, and you are to love others just as Christ loved you. To how much? To an extent that he gave himself for you, right? So remember, I told you last week, you are to love others, not only those who love you, but you are to love, you are to pay back to Jesus Christ by loving others. To what extent? There is no extent. By giving up your everything, giving up yourself. And then verse 3 says, this is how you should also walk in love. Let's read verse 3 together. But among you, there must not even be a hint of sexual immorality or of any kind of impurity or of greed, because these are improper for God's holy people. Yes, how else can you walk in love? First of all is what? You should not walk in sexual immorality. That is what? Any sexual relationship outside of marriage, you should not have, you should not do this. And the second thing is what? Impurity. This is a little more broad. Your thinking or your watching, right, should be pure. You should not be, the word here comes from a Greek word, porneia, which comes from pornography, right? So the second impurity, right, we should not have, you know, it's a broad term. Your thinking, your sight, right, should not be impure. And the third term here is greed, right? Greed is opposite of love. Greed is thinking about yourself. Love is thinking about others, right? So sexual immorality, impurity, greed are all related. Sexual sins, right? What kind of greed, right? You're greeding about sexual desires. You want to satisfy. You want to gratify yourself. So you don't have to walk in love by satisfying your sexual desire, but you are to walk in love by offering yourself for others, right? And it says what? There must not even be a hint of sexual immorality, impurity, or greed. There should not even be a little, you know, people should not even question your sexual sins, right? Some people might say, hey, I live with the other sex, right? I'm not having any sexual relationship. I'm just living with them. I'm just sharing an apartment, right? But even that, right? There should not be even a hint. Even, you know, you should even make other people question your sexual sins, right? That's what it's saying. For these are improper for God's people. And then verse 4, how else can we walk in love? Nor should there be obscenity, foolish talk, or coarse joking, which are out of the place, but rather thanksgiving, right? So it's talking about our speech, right? When we walk in love, we have to be careful about our speech. There should not be obscenity, right? There should not be filthy talk, shameful talk, dirty talk, indecent talk, right? That's what it means. And then it says what? There should not be foolish talk, right? What is a foolish talk? It's talk of a fool, a person who does not know God, a person who does not live according to God's wisdom. What do? Right? They spend time in the cafe, drinking coffee, and talking about silly things that has nothing to do with God. They talk about how much money they have. They talk about what they're going to do with their money. They're going to go on this trip, or they're going to spend this foolish talk that has nothing in God in there. Right? That is a silly talk that we should not walk in. And then the third one here is what? We walk in love by not coarse joking. What is coarse joking? You make fun of others so that you can get a laugh. Right? 2006, I was attending a seminary in South Korea, and I was in an elevator of that seminary, and the elevator was packed. There was a preaching professor in there, I was in there, and there were about 7 or 8 students in there. We're packed, we're going from first floor to the fifth floor, and then the preaching professor asked me, hey, what's your name? My name is Stanley. And then he says, are you Korean? I says, no, I'm Gyopo. And then the preaching professor made a joke, hey, then are you from Thailand? And then, you know, because my skin is a little darker than other people, and so everyone started laughing. And then, you know, I laughed as well, but inside, you know, I didn't feel good because he was making a joke and by putting me down so that everyone could laugh. So this is what coarse joking is, making fun of others so that you can get a laugh, right? So there should be no obscenity, foolish talk, or coarse joking, but what should take the place of that? But rather, thanksgiving, right? What should we do? If there's more thanksgiving, then there's less what? There's less obscenity, less foolish talk, less coarse joking, right? But when we don't give thanks, what happens? The other side increases, right? So number verse 4 is what? We should walk in love by watching our speech. And then it tells us why. Why should we walk in love? Verse 5, let's read that together. For of this you can be sure, no immoral, impure, or greedy person, such a man as an idolater, has any inheritance in the kingdom of the Christ and of God, right? Why should you live like this, right? He says emphatically, for this you can be sure. You can be sure. What is this? No immoral, no impure person, right? No greedy person will go to heaven, right? That's why you should not act like this, right? A greedy person here is referred to as an idolater, idol, right? Why do people have idols, right? Even in the Old Testament, there are a lot of idols, right? Each region had a different idol, right? Some were carved out of wood, some were made out of gold, right? Why do people have idol? They think if they worship that idol, if they sacrifice to that idol will hear their request, right? So they're greedy, all right? That's why they worship idols, right? For these people will have what? No inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. You should not live this way, because people who live in this way, what is their destiny? They will go to hell, right? But what happened? Verse 6, let no one deceive you with empty words. But people were deceiving, hey, it doesn't matter, you can live this way. Because why? There's no hell. God's not going to punish if you disobey God, right? For because of such things, God's wrath comes on those who are disobedient. So there were some false teachers who says what? Hey, you don't have to walk in love. God's not going to punish you. God is full of love. God is full of mercy. You know, God is full of patience, right? So don't worry, right? In 2007, a few weeks ago, I told you about this theologian pastor called Rob Bell, who he's a pastor, and he says, hey, homosexuality is okay. But he became popular in 2007. He was a senior pastor of a church in Michigan called Mars Hill. 7,000 people attend every week. And what did he say? There is no hell. There is no hell. Jesus came to save everyone. Everyone will be saved. No matter, even though they accept Christ or doesn't accept Christ, whether they go to church or not, right? Whether they do good deeds or bad deeds, Jesus came to save everyone. So everyone will be saved. There is no hell. And that's what he said, right? If Rob Bell is correct, then guess who's wrong? Jesus is wrong. The Bible is wrong. All the prophets in here is wrong. And that's the false teachers that was in Ephesians who were saying, hey, it doesn't matter what kind of life you live. You still go to heaven. God is merciful. God is loving, right? But they are all wrong, right? Yes, God is merciful. He sent us Jesus Christ. Yes, God is loving. Why? He's not coming today. He's waiting. He's waiting. The fact that he's waiting is why? He wants your family and your friends to enter the kingdom of heaven before he comes back, right? We see God's love and mercy, but at a day, at a time we do not know, he's going to come back, and then what? There will be a judgment. There will be a heaven and hell, and it's very clear, right? So verse 7 ends in this way, therefore do not be partakers with them. Why would you want to be one with them when their destiny is hell, when their destiny is death, right? Maybe if you have children, why would you want to associate with these friends, with these gang, when all they do is bad things, when all the result will be, what? Prison. Result will be bad things. Why would you want to associate with them? Therefore, do not be partakers with them. Right? So verses 1 through 7 says what? Walk in love. Because you have this faith, walk in love. And then we go to the second section, verse 8 through 14. Walk in light. Walk in light. Let's read verse 8 together. For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Live as children of light. Right. So it says, you were once darkness, right? You were once of the world, but now you are what? Light in the Lord. Right? So therefore, walk as children of light. Live as children of light. And how does that look like? Verse 9. For the fruit of light consists of all goodness, righteousness, and truth. If you live a life of light, if you walk in light, what does that look like? It will be, you live a life of all goodness, all righteousness, and truth, right? And what does walking in light mean? Verse 10, and find out what pleases the Lord, right? That's what it means to walk in light. When we walked in darkness, when we were in darkness, what did we do? We were Lord, we were owner. We decided what to do with our money. We decided what to do with our time. We decided what our future is going to be. We decided where we're going to live. But now what? We're walking in the night. What is our, who is our new owner? Our God is our new owner. And what should we do? We find out what pleases the Lord, right? All of us work, and we have an owner, we have a boss. And what do we do? Boss, what shall we do today? What do you want me to do today, right? Are you the boss at your workplace? Do you do what you want to do? No, we do what our employer wants us to do, right? So what do we do? What does walking in light means? It's to search the scripture, to find out what God wants me to do. What pleases the Lord? What does God want me to do with my time? What does God want me to do with my money? What does God want me to do with my future, right? That's what walking in light is, right? To find out, to search the scripture diligently, to find out what pleases the Lord, right? Is that how you walk? That's what it's saying. And verse 11, walking in light, have nothing to do with the fruitless deeds of darkness, but rather, what? Expose them, right? So don't do anything to do with fruitless deeds of darknesses, but what is your role? To expose sin, to expose darkness, right? John 16:8, what does the Holy Spirit do? It convicts people of sin. It exposes sin, right? So this is what it means. Let me show you. Yesterday, for example, Alvin worked, probably got up at 4 o'clock. You know, he went home, rushed home, and then came to church. And then by the time I saw him, he looked very tired. His eye, you know, eyes were closing, right? And then, you know, I was very, you know, touched by his faith. And he shined. He exposed sin to us. Oh, man, I should not be lazy in serving God. I should not give tiredness an excuse for not serving God. You see what it means? We should live a life of light. And what do? When we live a life of light, we expose the sin of others, right? For example, Joey shared in the beginning, right? These bad things are going in my life, but I still believe and trust God. And what does that do? It exposes sin in other people's life. Wow, I'm not doing that. The bad things are going in my life, and I'm complaining to God. You see how light, we're supposed to walk in light, live as light, and we expose other people's sin. That is what our calling. That is our calling. That is what we're supposed to do. You know, when I was going to church in Korea in my 20s, my pastor was very holy, very dedicated to God. And every time I would be near that pastor, I always felt like a sinner. She would expose every kind of sin. Because why? She shined light in every way, right? By her giving her life to God, by praying, you know, a few hours a day, right? I look at her and go, wow, compared to her, my prayer life is not where it should be. My dedication to God is not where it should be, right? And so this is what it's talking about. We are to expose the sins of others by living a life of light, right? And verse 12 says what? For it is shameful even to mention what the disobedient do in secret, right? All of us have a dirty little secret, right? That not even our spouse knows, right? God knows. It's shameful even to mention what the disobedient do in secret, right? So how can we expose that sin? I might not know what Alvin's dirty little secret is, but by shining my light, by living how I should live, he sees me and they go, wow, you know, I should stop that dirty little secret, right? That's what this verse is saying. But verse 13, but everything exposed by the light becomes visible, for it is light that makes everything visible. This is why it says, and this section finishes with a quotation, wake up, O sleeper, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you, right? This is a quotation, but there is no direct Old Testament. Scholars think that Paul combined a couple of verses in Old Testament and put this together, right? What is Paul doing here? Reminding the Gentile Christians, hey, remember how Jesus shined in your life, right? And that you escaped darkness and you came into light, Right? Jesus is the capital L light. Right? Mm-hmm. Jesus shines in their light. And what are they supposed to do? They are supposed to be light and shine in other people's light. Do you understand this? Mm-hmm. Right? So, Jesus is light. God's word is light. Mm-hmm. And what are we supposed to do? Look at Jesus. Look at his word. Shine that word in our life, expose our sin, walk in light, and what are we supposed to do? Expose the sin of others as we walk the life of light in our family, in our workplace. So we need to walk in light, just as Jesus shined his light and showed us we are a sinner, right? We are to we are to be that little light to other people. And then the last section, verses 15 to 21, walk in wisdom. Walk in wisdom. Since you've been saved, since you received grace, you need to walk in wisdom, right? Be very careful then how you live, how you walk. Not as unwise, but as wise. So what does, Proverbs 16 says what? How much better to get wisdom than gold? What is wisdom? It's the ability to see things as God sees and to live accordingly, right? Are you living a wise life? Right? Many people think to live wise is what the world tells us, right? Many people think that God's word is foolish, right? But God says, but the foolishness of God is wiser than the wisdom of man. What kind of life is wise? Let's see if you're living a wise life. Verse 16, let's read that together. Well, the first way to live a wise life. There you go. Making the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. Right? What kind of life is a wise life? Making the most of every opportunity. Right? Not wasting your time. Using your time fruitfully for the Lord. Right? Mm-hmm. Just think about how you spend your time. How do you spend your free time? Are you making the most of every opportunity to serve God? Or are you wasting time on temporary, useless, godless things, right? One of the things I cherish the most is time, right? So people talk about what is your love language? Is it giving? Is it saying good things? Mine is spending time, right? Because I don't have much money, my giving is time. When I give time, that means you are really important. That's what it means. Because why? So I don't like wasting time. That's why I do several things, many things. I work at school, I serve at church, I study on the side, and I do this and that because time is so precious. You cannot take back time, right? But we must remember what? Time is given by God. God gave us time by bringing us into this world where every day that we can live is a gift. It is a gift from God. We're to make every opportunity. Why? Because the days are evil, right? Because the days are limited. We don't know when Jesus is coming back. Yeah. So we are to make most of every opportunity. So are you living a wise life? Are you living a foolish life? Wasting all the opportunity that God has given you, right? Every minute we live is a gift from God, right? We don't think about it. We think, at least I'll live to 80 years old, right? But what a foolish talk, right? God, it is because God gives us, allows us to wake up every morning, right? He gives us the opportunity. We are to make every opportunity, every day, because it is a gift of God, right? And the second way, let's read verse 17 together. Second way to live a wise life. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is, right? This is connected to the first one. How are we to make most opportunity? Right? We are to understand what the Lord's will is. Right? What does God want me to do? Why did God call me into this world? What is the mission? Right? What is my purpose in life? What am I supposed to do? Do you know what the Lord's will is? When you know the direction you're going, you're going to spend less time doing useless things, right? And you'll just go the right direction, right? If you still don't know what the Lord's will is in your life, what are you doing? You're wasting time, right? You're squandering your time, just like the prodigal son. You're wasting everything down. So wise life is knowing what the Lord's will in your life is, right? So I think my Lord's will in my life is to serve God through preaching and teaching. So I'm doing, using every opportunity to study more, to grow more, to use that gift, right? So what is the Lord's will in your life? What does the Lord will you to do? When we know that, right, we make the most opportunity. And then number three, what is a wise life? Let's read verse 18 together. Do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled with the Spirit, right? Do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Debauchery is, you know, it's a kind of a very bad word, to just waste your life, right? Don't waste your life by drinking. Let me read to you what the Proverbs say about drinking. Right, let me find that verse here. Proverbs 23. Right? Very interesting. This is what the Proverbs 23, 31 to 33 says. Do not gaze at wine when it's red, when it sparkles in the cup, when it goes down smoothly. In the end, it bites like a snake and poisons like a viper. Your eyes will see strange sights and your mind imagine confusing things. Right? If you think about it, wine, liquor, alcohol leads to all kind of sins. What kind of sins? Right? You get drunk, a lot of people start fighting. You drink and drive and you get into car accidents. You drink and you start, you know, raping people, a lot of that. You drink and it breaks people apart, right? You go to Las Vegas, they offer free liquor, wine. Then you're gonna what? You're gonna be out of control, you're gonna spend all your money, you're gonna gamble, right? Drinking causes health problems, drinking causes you to lose control of yourself, right? You know, my professor always says, 9 out of 10 people who drink, it, you know, destroys their life. 9 out of 10 people who drink, right? And he always tells us, would you let something in your house that has a 9 out of 10 chances of killing your family, right? Would you let something in your house that had a probability of 9 out of 10 chances of killing your family? And that's what we do when we drink alcohol, when we get drunk on wine, right? We lose control. We let Satan control us and lead us to all kinds of sin. And verse 18 says what? Instead, a wise life is what? To be filled, to continually fill yourself with the Holy Spirit, right? This is a wise life, to continually fill yourself with the Holy Spirit. And then you will ask yourself, look, how can I be filled with the Holy Spirit? And so the verse explains to us, the last three verses tells us 4 ways we can be continually filled with the Holy Spirit. Verse 19, the first way is, we can be filled with the Holy Spirit by speaking to one another with psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, right? What does that mean? Right, when we think about praise, right? I think I told you a couple months ago, we only think about praising God, right? But here it's what? Praising God to other people, right? Speak to one another with psalms. Praise God to others. Praise God to others through hymns. Praise God through others through spiritual songs. This is how you can be filled with the Holy Spirit. If God has blessed you, don't keep it to yourself. Right? You share with others. Right? And you become filled with the Holy Spirit. You become more abundant, more filled with grace. Right? Are you doing this? Are you amplifying the grace of God in your life? Right? When you share, right, it becomes multiplied. And that's how you become filled with the Holy Spirit. So I pray that you not only praise God, but that you praise God to others, right? For example, when you, if you're married, how can you, your love for your spouse grow? You tell other people, oh, my husband, my wife is so wonderful, right? When you do that, your love marriage gets better, it grows stronger, right? And it continues. The second way we can be filled with the Holy Spirit is what? Verse 19, sing and make music in your heart to who? To the Lord, right? This is when we praise God directly, right? This is the praise we usually think about, right? When we praise God, we become filled with the Holy Spirit. And verse 20, the third way to be filled with the Holy Spirit, let's read that together. Always giving thanks to God the Father for everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Third way we can be filled with the Holy Spirit is what? Every day, every moment, thank God. Thank God, right? And it says right here, right? Thank God for everything in the name of who? In the name of Lord Jesus Christ. Thank God for what He has done in Jesus Christ, right? So this is why every time you know, I lead music during my classes, Bible classes, I make sure I choose at least a song about Jesus Christ, right? When we sing about Jesus Christ, when we remember about God's love in Jesus Christ, what happens? His love, we remember His love, and it floods our heart, and we become filled with the Holy Spirit. And this is why I like to mention Jesus Christ in every sermon. Why? Because this is how we become filled with the Holy Spirit, as we give thanks to God every day and remember God's love in Jesus Christ, we become filled with the Holy Spirit, right? So even in chapters 4, 5, 6, Paul says, do this, do this, do this. But what does he always come back to? Because Jesus Christ has loved you, right? And then the fourth and last way we can be filled with the Holy Spirit is what? Verse 21, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. When we submit, right? When we subject, when we humble ourselves to each one another, we become filled with the Holy Spirit, right? And it talks about here. So this is, look with me, verses 22 to 33. Wives, submit to husband. Husband, submit to wives. Then you'll be filled with the Holy Spirit. Chapter 6, verses 1 through 4. Children, submit to your parents, and you'll be filled with the Holy Spirit. Parents, submit to your children, and you'll be filled with the Holy Spirit. Chapter 6, verses 5 through 9. Slaves or workers, submit to your boss, and you'll be filled with the Holy Spirit. Masters, owners, submit to your workers, and you'll be filled with the Holy Spirit. Right? So this is what it's talking about here. Four ways to be filled with the Holy Spirit. You know, about 15 years ago, when I was first saved, I did a lot of speaking to one another, praising God to other people. Back then, I forgot the exact, you know, right now we have Facebook and we have Twitter, but about 15 years ago, it was just starting. There was this site, I forgot what it was, but, you know, every day I'd pray, oh, God is so wonderful, you know, He's done this for my life, this for my life, and I would praise God in these internet sites, and I would be filled with the Holy Spirit. But, you know, nowadays I hardly go on Facebook, and I like to keep quiet, and I was just studying this, you know, I need to do more of this, I need to praise God, right? I should not keep it to my life. That's what, you know, as I studied this came to my mind. In the beginning, I was so full, and I shared about God's love to others. Right? So this section is talking about walk in love, walk in light, and walk in wisdom. As you know, last week was my first year anniversary, wedding anniversary, right? I'm married, right? So now what? I should live like I am married, right? It would be wrong to live like I'm not married, right? It would be wrong if I don't go home early every night and spend time with my friends. It would be wrong to live as if I'm not married by what? Talking with girls, right? By meeting girls one-to-one, by watching movie with girls, or by flirting with girls, or by, earning money and just using it myself. To live like I'm not married is very wrong. Why? Because I'm married. I'm married, so my lifestyle should change, right? Everything should change. I should live I'm married, right? So this is the same thing. You should not live as if you're not saved. You should not live as though you're still in darkness. You should live in light because you are in light. You should live like you're in Christ because you are in Christ. It would be wrong to live as if I'm not married. Do you get that? And this is what Paul is talking about. Live the life that you are. Live the life of the one you're calling. You are married now. You need to change. You need to live a married life how it should be. And this is what Paul is calling us, right? We are saved, we're a Christian, we're no longer this. So our lifestyle, our pattern of life should all change. We should walk in love, walk in light, and walk in wisdom. Amen. So this is God's words. I pray that God has spoken to your heart. So let's praise together. And I want us to pray, Lord, help me to walk. Help me to keep remembering your grace and to live the life worthy of our calling. Thank you. Father, thank you, Lord. Thank you for your word, Lord. Thank you for speaking to our hearts. So, Lord, help us to live a life worthy of your calling, Lord. Help us to walk accordingly, Lord. We thank you. We love you.